Yes. I want to show you how complex our situation is. So my first slide showed a number of the dilemmas and barriers that we are to. Today it is so that the only thing the international society seems to be able to agree upon is that global heating should stay below 2 degrees. If we want to stay below those 2 degrees, then at least 50% of all fossil reserves should stay underground. Just think about how should this happen? Do you think the owners would let them stay underground? And at the same time, the industrial countries now promote oil from tar sand and shale gas. So, I mean, it's completely ridiculous. This will not be fulfilled.
Yeah.
One of the most central themes that is not taken serious is that there are limits to growth on a limited globe. This was already demonstrated in 1972 by the famous report, The Limits to Growth. I happened to be involved in that from the beginning, and I tried to convince people for 4 years that this should be taken seriously, but it is not. All industrial countries are now crying for more economic growth to solve the financial crisis. Again, it's absurd. And another thing is that if you want to have limited growth on economic and material growth, then you must have more equity in the world. Because if it's very non-equity, people will want more growth. But what happens? Inequity is increasing. I'm just showing you some of the complex dilemmas. So, and what do the international society do to try to promote the green transition? They give 6 times more state support to fossil fuels than to renewables. So, we would say, those barriers and dilemmas are so hard to overcome, but I will try to show you that of course they are not natural doors. We can overcome them if we decide to and can create a majority to decide so. And then finally, I emphasize is that if you look at the economy, and that's what you're here for, then the dominating neoliberal economy system cannot survive without growth, without economic growth. So you see, there are a few dilemmas. So let's go on from that. Yeah. Then I've been asked to say a few words about green growth. And I can do that quickly because I think that the concept of green growth is really an excuse to continue economic growth in the usual way, but giving a green case. And that is so because all the claims that you can decouple from carbon, from emission of carbon dioxide, this is not true. You can have less relative carbon dioxide. But nature doesn't care about relative, they care about absolute decoupling, and there is no absolute decoupling in our present system. So it's just an illusion. Then the thing that people don't think about is that you know that there are about 10,000, if you lose solar energy, down to the earth comes about 10,000 times the energy that we use now. But if you look at what are realistic to use, then you will also discover that even solar energy are limited. So there are many, many reasons that we should stop talking about green growth and try to see how can we make the transition to a sustainable world. And I think it's too late now already to accept those mitigation concepts. So my advice, and I'll finish the green growth, is forget about green growth. It's simple nonsense, and they should not be allowed to go on with that. And now I come to this central concept, really, which is renewable. This one. As I said, the report came out already in 1972. And I think one of the main reasons that people do not take it seriously is that they have, of course, know that productivity in industrial countries increases about 2% per year. Maybe a little less now, but about 2% per year. And this means that there's no economic growth and that 2% less working places next year. So this is their main excuse, because they say, then if we don't have growth, there will be more unemployment. And this is a very peculiar argument, because there's no natural law that says that we should work 37 hours per week.
Yeah.
Do the politicians not realize there is a very simple solution to have a flexible employment concept? So when there are lack of jobs, we just lower the working hours in the week. So we have more free time and more life quality. What is wrong with that?
Yeah.
And if it goes the other way, okay. So for some time, maybe once a year, the parliament decides that this next year you go down sometime, but if it goes the other way, you go up somehow, okay, that can solve all the problems. And already in the 1930s, I will advise some of you to read John Maynard Keynes, the British economist. He said, take care of employment, and the budget will take care of itself. And that's a very important economic thing. But I think it also has a very important moral implication. I think it's immoral that human beings should be forced out into unemployment. If they want to have a job, why should some people in the world be unemployed and even in a very bad situation? There are really important reasons why we should have a flexible working hour system. So remember that when you hear all the nonsense about that you cannot do it. Then of course, if you go to a higher level, the international problem, then you all know that we have had the one fiasco after the other. Maybe the worst one was the Copenhagen COP15 in Copenhagen in 2009, where our Prime Minister made a fool of himself completely. But after that, the fiascos have continued. There's one very interesting thing that people don't seem to know so much about. That was that in 2007, the German Chancellor Angela Merkel she's a physicist and chemist, so she knows something about it. And she spoke in New York, made a very important speech, and said, why do you think that the developing world should accept that it's a rich world that emit 10 times as much CO2 than they do per capita? Why should they accept that? So the only way we can get international agreement on how to stop this thing is to say that if we look forward to 2050 and then make a system that she called contraction and conversion, where you allow the developing world to increase their emission but then go down towards 2050, so that in 2050 every man and woman on the globe has the same right for emission. Today it's like the industrial countries emit 10 times as much as India and so on. So I think that was a very important speech. When Merkel came back to Germany, She had forgot to tell her department about that speech. And then the whole German industry said, are you mad? You cannot have that. And then she has been silent since. And she happened to say the truth in 2007. Unfortunately, now she can't say anything about it. I will say one thing more about Minister Growth. And that's the only curse I will bother you with. Because some Dutch scientists have tried to look at what has happened since 1972 until today. And they then compare two of the scenarios from the report. One was what they call the collapse scenario, and the other one was called the balance scenario, or the stabilized world. And it's shocking to see that all the data follows exactly the collapse scenario. And the collapse scenario is then collapsing in the middle of the century. So I think it's one convincing thing that the report, Minister Growth, was really very happy or very lucky, or unlucky, if you want. So that one of the scenarios was exactly what we are foolish enough to do. So people say that this is just nonsense. It's not nonsense, it's reality. So now I was told that I should be rushed off, so I'll go on to about what can we do. And as I think already both the two previous speakers said, we know actually what we should do, but we don't do it. So I'll divide it and say, if you look at equity, there's no reason that in Denmark and other rich countries that we should have much more equity. And there's a very simple way to do it. You just have a strongly increasing progressive tax on income, fortune, houses, and inheritance. Why should we keep on having those social inequities that rich people's children can inherit the whole thing and pay nearly nothing in the inheritance tax? Then, of course, you hear about the rich people crying out and saying, well, then we will leave the country and we cannot afford everyone. I'll say one thing. I happen to be member of the board of a number of Danish industrial companies. So I know all those excuses. The last one I was on was Danisco. And I heard these things, and that our directors would then leave the country. The truth is that none of those directors could have any job in the foreign country with the same salary. They're not very clever, and one hurts you. They can't get a good job, it's only empty sites. So forget about the rich country, the rich people leave us. They can't do it if they want to do it. It's another thing that scares me, of course, and I guess also scares you. That is that we are really undermining our democracy.
Yeah.
Woo!
What has money to do in democracy? Nothing. Democracy is based on arguments, discussions, really looking and listening to each other, so on. But not money should not decide. And what happens in the United States today, I don't think the United States has a democracy anymore. And I'm afraid it's in the same way. But money decides more and more. So that's also very simple to change, because the parliament can just decide that it's illegal. It's illegal to give money to the commercial and private money, to political parties and to politicians. My virtue, what have this to do in our political system? Nothing there. And of course then you can have the same supplementary system that all parties have some government support for campaigns and books and so on and so forth. So it's only the arguments that counts, not money. And I think that's very important, because as long as money decides, we cannot make those changes. We have to change those systems also. Then I'm so happy that the two Nobel Prize winners, Joseph Stiglitz and Paul Krugman, has really declared there's no scientific basis for our present neoliberal problems, and it's more harmful than useful. But I also think we should not forget history. Not so many of you young people perhaps know about Roosevelt's New Deal in the 1930s. He was already completely aware, he really saved the American economy because he accelerated public investments and strong market regulations. And that's the thing that has also been completely forgotten. Keynes said in the 1930s that if you want to ruin the global economic system, just allow capital to move freely. If you do that, you are certain to destabilize the global economic system. Some of you may remember that until the 1980s, Denmark did not have control. You could not just move capital out of Denmark. You had to have a national bank. And Keynes said you should have a universal system, or at least all central banks should control capital movements. Because otherwise you'd have all those financial crises, destabilizing things and so on. And that's exactly what we do. In the 1980s, EU changed the system, so now we must have free capital movement. Exactly the opposite of what Keynes advised us. Wow, you're so stupid. And then we have Denmark, I'll take Denmark as an example, an economic wise council that is not wise at all. They are all old-fashioned neoliberal economists, so we could decide next year to fire this council and make a more clever council. That was under the national actions. Then I'll say a little bit about the international actions that we could vote for. And yes, I have already mentioned Keynes that said that we should have control of capital movements. But I think there are other things we could do, and that of course depends on the United Nations. WTO is a completely silly thing, and that's only one thing. So the first thing we should do is to replace WTO by a new trade administration. And this trade administration should have as its first priority to have more equity and to have environmental considerations, and therefore introduce a global transport tax and token tax. Of course, if you cannot get UN to do that, I think one should not give up. We should make a competitive one. So that the clever countries will say, now we make our own WTO, our own trade administration, with a completely different priority, and all the clever countries could join that instead of WTO. And then of course, if you say things like that, people say you're completely naive, you're completely crazy. But we have to be naive and crazy if we want to do the things that are needed. And we also have to change the priorities of the World Bank and the IMF so that they have first priority transition to a green and global equity. And this means again that we may have to create an alternative to the World Bank, a Green World Bank, and so on. But let us use our imagination, and let us not, and I'm so glad there's so many young people here, so it's you that are supposed to promote this thing. And also, one could stop, really have government subsidies for fossil fuels. It's completely idiotic when we want to have a green transition that gives six times as much money to fossil fuels and to renewable energy. But how does it get started? That's a $1,000 question. I have only It's not a very genius idea, but maybe I have no genius idea, but my hope is that some of the more civilized nations, and I think I have 5 minutes, I can do it in 5 minutes. I think that the Nordic countries in some ways are rather civilized. We have realized many of the things I've talked about. So maybe the Nordic countries could start breaking out. They have to break out in you also. But that's okay with me.
Yes.
Yeah.
if we did that, we are more than 20 million people, if we take all the Nordic countries, we are rich, we are well educated, we are civilized and so on. We could start the whole revolution. But that depends that the young people start the revolution. And my main advice is we should not wait for US and China, because they are so reactionary anyhow. And then the last thing I'll say is about my references that comes here. Yes. I'm so immodest that because there are some ideas about that. If you want to take part in this thing, start with my little book. It's only 88 pages, it doesn't cost 135. Go on to Johannes T. Nielsen's Green Transition and finish with what's Jackson's new book, that is really very complete one. And you can also, I've been part of a project that shows how advantageous it would be for Denmark to make those steps. And then my last words, allow me to speak in Danish, if you allow me. Yeah, fordi den lille bog, jeg har skrevet, jeg er ikke så åben mere, det er et slags testament, kan jeg også. Slags testament, hvor jeg har prøvet at give analysen og forestå kort og klart, hvad kan vi gøre. Og så ender jeg med en lille afsnit på den anden side, der hedder efterskrift til mine børnebørns generation. Jeg har 12 børnebørn. Og derfor vil jeg nøjes med bare at læse det aller sidste ord, der står i din efterskrift, og så skal jeg slutte. Jeg skriver om, den gode nyhed er, at der allerede er en spirende erkendelse i jeres forældres generation for behovet for markant nytænkning. Den dårlige nyhed er, at den globale pengemagt har sat sig solidt på store dele af den politiske kommunikations- og beslutningsproces. Derfor bliver det en hård kamp, men heldigvis ikke en håbløs kamp. Jeg ønsker jer held og lykke med kampen, det får I brug for.